RNA polymerases in eukaryotes. These are the enzymes that are responsible for using DNA as a template and synthesizing RNA. In fact, all genes of DNA that give rise to RNA, whether it is mRNA, tRNA, rRNA, small nuclear RNA, etc. And all of these together contribute to what is called as a transcriptome of the cells. So let us look at the learning outcomes of this session. The RNA polymerases in eukaryotes are basically three types, and each type is specific for transcription of certain specific genes. The RNA polymerases that are divided into polymerase 1, 2, and 3, all of them share a common core with peripheral subunits that vary from one to the other, thereby contributing to certain specific functions that are attributed to each one of them. They have the typical crab claw structure, which is also observed in the RNA polymerase of the prokaryotes. And they also have another common feature, which is called as a stalk. And this stalk enables several processes, such as RNA splicing, 5' capping, etc. And also binding to the histones to either carry out histone remodeling or histone modifications, etc. All three RNA polymerases are associated with transcription factors, and this enables them to carry out proper transcription process. Now let us look at the structural similarities between the RNA polymerase of the prokaryotic system and that of the eukaryotes. So as mentioned earlier, you can see that the RNA polymerase of both the prokaryotes and the eukaryotes are having what is called as the crab claw shape. So this typically is what is called as a crab claw, okay? And you can very clearly observe that these domains are what is contributing to making the pincers of the crab claw. And you right in between these pincers, within the pincers, is the central catalytic cleft where the transcription bubble is formed. And there are several domains that are present over here with very typical structures that enable forming channels through the RNA polymerases. So you have an RNA exit channel, you have a nucleotide entry channel, you have the DNA entering from this point, and you can have the pincers closing and opening. When it opens and closes, that decides the conformation in which the RNA pol is for initiating transcription. What one also observes is you have what is called as the alpha CTD tail, and that tail is present in both the RNA polymerase as well as the eukaryotic RNA polymerase as well as the prokaryotic RNA polymerase. Now, when you look at the RNA polymerases types, that is 1, 2, and 3, 1 is primarily associated with the nucleolus in the nucleus, and it is responsible for synthesizing the ribosomal RNAs. An interesting study is that alpha amanitin, which is obtained from mushrooms, are able to inhibit the functioning of the RNA polymerases. But what has been observed is that the RNA polymerase 1 is not affected by alpha amanitin at all. When you go to RNA polymerase 2, it is found in the nucleoplasm and is responsible for synthesizing most functional or structural genes that give rise to mRNA precursors and also what is called as a small nuclear RNA. This, of course, is very strongly inhibited by the alpha amanitin. You have the type 3, which is also present in the nucleoplasm, and this is mainly responsible for synthesis of tRNA and 5S rRNA. And this too is inhibited, but it needs high concentrations of alpha amanitin to inhibit the polymerase activity. What is important and interesting to notice that polymerase 1 and 3 levels in the cells are very much dependent on the amount of protein synthesis, for very practical reasons that if protein synthesis is, or proteins that are synthesized by a cell are more, then you will need more of ribosomes carrying out the translation, and also you would need charged tRNA to enable the bringing the amino acids to synthesize the polypeptides. So if the cell needs a greater amount of proteins, then invariably the expression of the genes responsible for eukaryotic RNA polymerase 1 and 3 become active. RNA polymerase 2 is responsible for transcribing almost 35,000 different genes when you consider the mammalian system or the higher eukaryotic system. Now, RNA pol 1 synthesizes actually the 47S pre-rRNA, and that is broken into or cleaved into 18S, 5.8S and 28S rRNA. And the pol 3, like mentioned, does not synthesize any RNA that is to be translated. It will synthesize RNA that is not translated. So tRNA and 5S rRNA are not translated. And also what has been very critically observed is that the size of the RNA that is synthesized is not greater than 300 nucleotides, unlike what you observe for RNA polymerase. RNA polymerase 2 can actually synthesize very long RNA transcripts. Now let us have a closer picture of RNA polymerase 12. Well, it has approximately 10 to 12 subunit core, and right from RPB1 to RPB12, they are arranged to form the crab claw structure, just like the RNA polymerase of the eukaryote, which is alpha 2 beta beta prime omega, makes a claw crab. That way, you have 10 to 12 subunits of the RNA polymerase that is able to form the entire crab claw structure. Another important distinction between the RNA polymerase 2 of the eukaryotes and of the prokaryote is that the extra subunits that are present in the RNA polymerase 2 is mainly required for binding to transcription factors or to regulatory molecules that would help the RNA pol to actually begin transcription. So in the eukaryotic system, there is a much larger complexity, and also therefore has to have a highly regulated mechanism, and that's the reason why there are many molecules that basically ensure whether the transcription has to happen or it doesn't have to happen. Now, the RPB1 is equivalent to the beta subunit of the prokaryotic RNA polymerase, while RPB2 is equivalent to the beta prime subunit of the prokaryotic RNA pol. Together, the two subunits, that is RPB1 and RPB2, they come together to form a part of what is called as the active cleft center. And this is where you have the transcription bubble positioned, and the catalytic activity of using the DNA template and synthesizing the RNA all happens within the active cleft center. Now, the RPB3 also contributes to formation of the core cleft. So it's observed that when RPB3 is not present, then the positioning or the conformation of the RPB1, RPB2 is not conducive enough for the catalytic activity. So RPB3 is known to basically help in forming the core cleft. Then you have RPB5. RPB5 is responsible for interacting with transcription factor, and also it is responsible for binding to DNA, because it is at this point that DNA enters the RNA polymerase. So this has an important role to actually position the DNA within the RNA polymerase, and then based on this interaction, they are able to help in closing or opening the pincers to ensure that the transcription bubble is formed properly. Then you have the RPB6, which helps in transcription elongation process, and this also is observed to be able to interact with transcription factor 2S. The RPB9 is responsible for transcription initiation and proofreading. It has a role to play in that. RPB10 and RPB12, they are small subunits, but they are basically required for the complete polymerase assembly. Then you have the RPB11, which is actually the largest subunit in the RNA polymerase 2. And this basically has a role to play in subunit-subunit interaction. So again, it helps in assembly of the RNA polymerase too. So likewise, if you can see right from RPB1 to RPB12, each one of them contributes to the actual functioning of the RNA polymerase too. Now let us make a comparison of 1, 2, and 3 with respect to its structural components. So when you look at the structure of RNA pol 1, 2, and 3, pol 1 is made up of 14 different subunits, and that's why it's a heterodimer. Pol 2 is made up of 12 subunits. This is comprising RPB1 to RPB12. And you have pol 3, which is made up of 17 subunits, and it is again a heterodimer. Now, basically what has been observed is that pol 2 is able to bind to a lot of transcription factors to initiate or form the pre-initiation complex. So what you see here over here is RNA pol 2 binding to several different transcription factors like the Tata binding protein, TF transcription factor 2B, 2A, 2F, likewise. And this complex that is formed is what is called as a pre-initiation complex. And interestingly, what is being suggested is this, that when you look at the structure of pol 1 and pol 3, there is similarity and yet there is uniqueness in its function. And also what has been observed is that it is heterodimer and much bulkier than the RNA pol 2. Okay, and the basic proposal or hypothesis that is made is that many of the transcription factors that may have been associated with pol 3 earlier have now become a part of the core complex of the pol 3. So the number of transcription factors that actually bind to pol 3, when you compare it with the number that binds to pol 2, is much lesser. Also, what is, many studies have shown, for example, the pol 3 is able to carry out termination on its own without the requirement of external proteins, because the components that are present within the pol 3 are allowing or enabling this to happen. It is also helping in the RNA removal from the RNA polymerase core complex. So therefore, one basically understands that apart from polymerase activity, you have the pol 3 basically carrying out several different aspects of the transcription process itself. So it does not have just one function, but it is multifunctional, and that is attributed to fact that it is a multi-subunit complex. But each one of them shares the core complex, which means it shares RPB 1, 2, 8, 5, and 11. So you have all of them forming a core complex, and then over and above that, there are other subunits present. Interestingly, what has been observed is that all three also have a very common appearance or a structural aspect called the stalk. So in case of RNA pol 2, it is RPB4 and RPB7 that forms the stalk. Similarly, in case of pol 3 and pol 1, you have certain subunits forming the stalk region. The stalk region is actually playing a very important role because it helps in a lot of processes that are associated with RNA, whether you talk about RNA splicing, 5' capping, poly A tail formation, so RNA processing in general. Also, the stalk region is the one that associates with histones, so basically nucleosomes. And so chromatin form of DNA may make it inaccessible for RNA polymerase, but the stalk region interacts with these nucleosomes and somehow enables binding to the DNA to initiate the process of transcription. So these are certain commonalities and certain differences in the structures between RNA pol 1, 2, and 3. So let us make the concluding remarks. RNA polymerase 2 is a 12 subunit multicomplex that, on interacting with transcription factors, is the main polymerizing enzyme for mRNA synthesis. RNA polymerase 1 is a 14 subunit multicomplex that transcribes a large ribosomal RNA, which then is processed to form three different ribosomal RNA. RNA polymerase 3 is mainly associated with transcribing genes to form tRNA and 5S RNA. And this is the largest RNA polymerase with 17 subunits present. And interestingly, it is RNA polymerase that transcribes non-translated genes per se. RNA pol 1 also does that, but with RNA pol 3, definitely that is the case. All the three RNA polymerases share a common structure and the stalk, which is mainly involved in various processes such as RNA processing, histone binding, etc. Thus, RNA polymerases in the eukaryotes are able to initiate, elongate, terminate transcription to enable processes associated with RNA to proofread the transcription. And being a multi-subunit complex, they are also able to bind to other proteins to regulate the transcription process. Thank you.